Hello, everyone, and welcome to the CSS Security Mini Briefing, where we will present a short summary of what was released today, November 14th, 2023. My name is Josh Daniel, and I'm a risk manager in the customer service and support organization here at Microsoft. We're going to start this video with an overview of the release, talk about a couple items that have been in the news lately, and then we'll dive into a few of the vulnerabilities from today's release. Please note that the details of the vulnerabilities we are covering in this video may change, and the authoritative location for information will always be the online content in the security update guide. Now, before I dig into today's release, I like to compare it to the previous 12 months to see how it stacks up. And with that, there are a total of 58 vulnerabilities in today's release, and that's a little bit lower than our average over the past 13 months where we've been seeing around 78, a little bit more than 78 vulnerabilities in each release. There are 15 total remote code execution vulnerabilities. We've been averaging around just over 28. Next, I'll talk about scoring. Microsoft uses the Common Vulnerability Scoring System, or CVSS. This is a scale between 1 and 10 that allows software vendors to compare different vulnerabilities in a bubble. Not only vulnerabilities within each product, but vulnerabilities between different products or even vulnerabilities between different vendors. It's a starting point when we talk about risk, but it doesn't contain everything that's outside of a vulnerability. For example, whether it was exploited or not, or whether it was publicly disclosed. And in those cases, that would raise the risk, but it does not change the CVSS score. The highest rated CVSS score in this release is 9.8, and we've been averaging just about 9.5 over the past 13 months. The average CVSS score this month is at 7.59, which is a little bit higher than our average over the past 13 months of 7.33. Next, there are three publicly disclosed vulnerabilities in today's set, and we've been averaging one over the past 13 months in each release. And finally, I'll talk about vulnerabilities that are known to be exploited in the wild, where there are three in today's release, and we've been averaging just over two per release over the past 13 months. Now, onto an overview of today's release, where those of you familiar with this chart, we put the products that are serviced every single month towards the bottom half of the chart, and then as we move up, we get into products that are not necessarily serviced every month, and that's certainly the case this month. On the Windows side, we've been averaging between mid-30s to mid-40s, depending on the exact Windows product. And so this month we can see we're well below that average, and that's due to the total count being lower this month. As we move up the chart, we have four vulnerabilities in Office this month. We have four vulnerabilities in Exchange Server that are being addressed this month. As we continue moving up the chart, we get into developer tools such as .NET, ASP.NET, Visual Studio, .NET 6, 7, and 8. Those all have a handful of vulnerabilities that are being addressed. There's also a vulnerability in the Azure command line interface. And finally, to round it all off, there's a vulnerability in System Center Operations Manager, or SCOM, that's being addressed in this month's release. Now let's talk about a vulnerability, or two rather, that have been in the news over the past month. In October, the curl open source software released a number of vulnerabilities that were addressed in their latest release, 8.4.0. I'll talk about one of these in the section because it's highest scored vulnerability, but there's actually two of these vulnerabilities are applicable to Windows. This one here, CVE-2023-38545, but there's also another one, 38039, that are being addressed. There's no extra work to mitigate both of those vulnerabilities. The updated curl version is included in the November 14th cumulative updates for all the Microsoft products. So again, there's no extra work for these two separate vulnerabilities. But in terms of scoring and whatnot, I'll talk to this highest rated one. That is a remote code execution vulnerability in the SOX 5. It is a heap buffer overflow. This is rated as an important severity, publicly disclosed, but no known exploits out in the wild. In the worst case scenario, this has a base score of 9.8. The attack vector is over the network, the attack complexity is low, no privileges are required, but no user interaction is required. Now, this score comes directly from the CURL organization that released this vulnerability. And again, that's in the worst case scenario. And in Windows, it's a little bit different as far as what's vulnerable and not. And so that 9.8 score doesn't necessarily apply to the Windows products. There's other mitigations in play that, for example, increases the attack complexity. And so that score isn't necessarily with Windows, but that's an overall score that the open source project designated this vulnerability, again, in the worst case scenario. There are no document mitigations or workarounds for this vulnerability. The affected software is all versions of Windows that are in support. Again, in order to protect yourself from the vulnerability, all you would need to do is install the cumulative updates from November 14th or later, and you'll be protected from this. Those updates include CURL version 8.4.0 that addresses this vulnerability. Okay, so let's get into the vulnerabilities that are new to the November release. And the first one I'll talk to is CVE-2023-36033. This is an important elevation of privilege vulnerability. This one is both publicly disclosed and exploitation detected. This has a base score of 7.8 on that scale of 10. The attack vector is local. The attack complexity is low. Privileges required is low, and user interaction here is none. There are no documented mitigations or workarounds, and as far as affected software, it's all versions of Windows that are in mainstream support, whether that's Windows 10 or 11 on the desktop side, or Server 2016 up through Server 2022 on the server side. Next, I'll talk to CVE-2023-36025. This is an important security feature bypass vulnerability in the Windows Smart Screen component. This one was privately disclosed to Microsoft, but exploitation has been detected. This has a base score of 8.8 on that scale of 10. The attack vector is over the network. The attack complexity is low. No privileges are required, but user interaction is required in order to leverage this vulnerability. There are no documented mitigations or workarounds for this. And as far as affected software, it's all versions of Windows that are in mainstream support, whether that's Windows 10 and 11 on the desktop or Server 2016 through 2022 on the server side. And the last vulnerability that I'll talk to today is CVE-2023-36397. This is a critical remote code execution vulnerability in the Pragmatic General Multicast component, or PGM. As we can see, this has a base score of 9.8 on that scale of 10, so certainly elevated in terms of scoring. The attack vector is over the network, the attack complexity is low, privileges required is none, and user interaction here is also none. Now, one thing I'll point out here, when we talk about an unauthenticated remote code execution vulnerability that requires no user interaction, we would typically think, hey, this vulnerability is wormable. And in that vacuum of a scenario, that may be true. However, this vulnerability is only in play when Windows message queuing service is both enabled and the service is running, which is not a default configuration of Windows. So that reduces the footprint that this vulnerability could be leveraged against. And so I wouldn't call this myself a wormable vulnerability because it would only be applicable to a very small subset of machines rather than all Windows versions. There is a mitigation here, as I kind of mentioned, that Windows message queuing service needs to be enabled in order for the system to be exploitable. There are no document workarounds for this vulnerability. As far as affected software, it's all versions of Windows that are in support, whether that's desktop 10.11 or on the server side, 2016 through the latest 2022. Okay, that's all the vulnerabilities I have today. I want to thank everyone for joining me as I walk through some of the vulnerabilities from the November release. Thank you very much, and I will talk to you all next month.